Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for this week's Lecture in Planning series. My name is Maureen Abighanem, and I'm a PhD student here in Columbia's Urban Planning Program, and I'll be moderating the session. Today, as part of GSAPP's Career Month, we welcome a panel of practitioners working in international organizations. Our panel discussion is with Kate Owens, Principal Consultant and Adjunct Professor at Columbia's GSAPP, Aline Rahbany, Urban Programming Technical Director at World Vision International, and Samer Saliba, Head of Practice at the Mayor's Migration Council. Before introducing our speakers, I will start with a few brief logistical announcements and then launch into what I hope will be a spirited and informative discussion. So during the talk, I'd like to remind audience members to please mute their microphones. We will be recording today's panel, so anyone in the audience who wishes not to be recorded should turn off their video input. The chat box should be used only for discussion or questions regarding the session. If you have any technical questions that apply only to you, please message me or my co-host Joe Hennekens privately. After the speakers' presentations, we will have time for Q&A. We'll start Q&A around 2 p.m. so that we have enough time for everyone's questions, and I'll be coordinating the Q&A with attention to diversity and inclusion. So if you have already had the chance to ask a question, please allow others to do so before asking another one. And to ask a question, participants can either use the raise the hand feature in Zoom and we will call on you to unmute, or you may also type your questions in the chat box throughout the presentations and I can read them out loud during the Q&A session. So today's panel is titled International Planning, Addressing Urban Inequities. With that, I'm delighted to introduce our panelists for today. Kate Owens is Principal Consultant and Adjunct Professor at Columbia's GSAPP. She has been working at the intersection of sustainable transport, housing, and urban planning for nearly 20 years. Kate's career has spanned international and domestic planning by helping analyze and design housing and infrastructure projects in more than 30 cities. Kate holds a BA in public policy and economics from the University of Chicago and a PhD in planning from the University of Michigan. Kate's talk today, Advocating for Sustainable Cities, reflects on international urban narratives. She will begin by introducing the network of international planning institutions and then narrow down on three global development projects she was engaged in. The first, a loan by the World Bank for Tanzania's green infrastructure. The second describes the process of advocating and setting up an urban finance lab in India and Mexico with WRI. And the third depicts an asset management strategy with HRNA. Our second speaker, Aline Rahbany, is the Urban Programming Technical Director at World Vision International. Aline is a Lebanese based in Toronto since 2018. She holds a master's degree in public health from the American University of Beirut with a focus on community development and health behavior. She has been in the aid sector for over 10 years. At World Vision International, she works with more than 70 country offices on strategy and programming support to offices that prioritize addressing urban poverty and violence. Aline is passionate about inclusive cities and is an advocate for the deliberately oppressed, especially children and youth. Aline today will discuss how urban inequities are putting the aid sector to the test, especially in contested cities such as Beirut, Lebanon. She argues that urban inequities can quickly translate into conflict, rendering urban spaces as violent and risky. Such inequities are presenting an enigma to the aid industry. And within this framework, Aline will discuss her journey with World Vision International and share some of the innovative approaches they have developed to ensure that those who are most marginalized have their needs and their rights met. Last but not least, our third speaker is Samer Saliba, Head of Practice at the Mayor's Migration Council. Samer has over 10 years of experience working on making cities more inclusive of displaced and marginalized people. A Boston son of Lebanese immigrant parents, Samer has a BA in Urban Studies from Boston University, a Master's of Urban Planning from NYU Wagner School of Public Service, and is currently a PhD student at the New School's Milano School of Policy, Management, and the Environment. At the Mayor's Migration Council, Samer oversees technical assistance programming that supports city leaders in designing as well as implementing local policies, plans, and projects that address the need of refugees and migrants. As the former lead urban advisor at the International Rescue Committee, IRC, Samer worked directly with the cities of Amman, Athens, Milan, and Kampala, among others, to institutionalize inclusive projects within city government structures. In today's panel, Samer will speak to the Global Cities Fund for Inclusive Pandemic Response. With the vast majority of reported COVID-19 cases in urban areas, cities today are on the front lines of the global public health crisis. The pandemic presents unique challenges to urban migrants, refugees, and internally displaced persons due to their legal status, their reliance on the informal employment and economy, and their restricted access to public health services and benefits. This initiative will provide direct financial and technical support to five cities that are struggling to implement projects related to public health, livelihoods, and inclusive social services. Cities include Beirut, Barranquilla, Freetown, Lima, and Mexico City. So in today's panel, Kate, Aline, and Samer will come together to share their work across the globe. From India to Lebanon, Tanzania, Mexico, and beyond, they will speak to the challenges, opportunities, as well as growth urbanists face along the way while working in international organizations. So without further ado, I thought we could start by hearing from Kate, then Aline, then Samer about current projects that they're working on, the accomplishments they were able to secure to fight urban inequities despite all circumstances. So with that, Kate, if you're ready, I'll hand it over to you.
Great. Thanks, guys. Thank you for having me. It's pretty amazing to get to be on a panel with such other distinguished practitioners. It's so often that I'm in a place where I'm talking about theory. So it's so nice today. We're going to try to talk about what actually happens and can you actually do anything. That's when I become a little bit theoretical and academic, and I'm not sure I've accomplished as much as I want to in my career. But without further ado, I can't help myself. I said earlier, it's kind of a career hazard for me. I always have slides. Sometimes I think I think I shared the wrong one. Hold on. Let me share the right screen with you guys. Sorry. Still working on becoming a professional. Okay, are you guys seeing the main screen or do you see my notes? Main screen, okay, great. All right, so I just wanted to start with the first project I really ever worked on, which was with the World Bank. So just to give you a background on myself and kind of how I got here, I worked an undergrad in public housing in Chicago as the plan for transformation was happening. So public housing was coming down pretty quickly and getting redeveloped and kids were scattering all over the city. And it was a pretty big time in housing in Chicago. And I got pretty fascinated with it. And when I got out of college, there weren't a lot of jobs. And so I found myself, believe it or not, at the World Bank. And it was this opportunity to look at the same exact issues I'd seen in Chicago, but with whole different dimensions of problems, right? With, you know, a tenth the resources, 100 times faster urban growth, right? All these things were wild. And I got a chance to work with the lead housing advisor for the World Bank. And one of the projects that I got super involved in and is one that's never ended in my career. I'm always coming back to Ethiopia. And I like to say, it's guilty for me because what's happened to Addis, I like to say happened on my watch. I've been here the whole time, but I'm gonna tell you how I think we went wrong and kind of how things are changing. So this map is redeveloping Kabele housing in Ethiopia. So what happened is this, you see the image on the top, the kind of traditional housing in Ethiopian cities. Was state-owned, and they decided they were gonna raise all of it and create high-rise public housing, which is the thing down below. So the exact opposite of the direction Chicago was going, where I was coming from. And the red dots are like one of my first maps. I had to like dig this out from 2004, because I was like, how am I gonna frame this? And basically they just tore down all of inner Addis Ababa. And I bring this all up because we didn't think sustainably about it. The city wasn't thinking sustainably about it. I wasn't thinking sustainably about it. I was like a very card-carrying economist from University of Chicago. And I believed that, you know, we could get private markets to redevelop this, the city would function better. And it was, Addis at the time was a beautiful walkable city in Africa. You don't see a lot of those, often they're sprawling. And it was safe. And now Addis has some really big roads that are beautiful and they have an LRT, but you can't walk across Addis anymore. And the housing is, all of the people have to, the housing's now all on the outskirts. So they now have the problems that Chicago had when I first got there. So I've been trying to reflect, and I bring this all up because again, I kind of ended up at international institutions without meaning to. So with that in mind, and that is like the place I came from, I want to try to explain to you my academic piece here to set some ideas about how the network of all of this stuff happens in the international space. And the kids, anybody who took my class last semester, sorry, you've seen this, but I feel like it's something, it took me 20 years of practice to figure out. So I like to say this kind of a super complex network of actors. And the very center of all of this urban work are local and national governments. Often local governments are undermined, they're under-resourced, resourced like financially, and then people, like the number of people or hours, never ideas. And I always want to like put that at the center. And then the first kind of inner group for me, and I think we'll hear some really cool stories from this space a bit today, is that you then have kind of NGOs and advocacy groups. And I bring all this up because I thinking about where you guys could work if you want to be in this space, these are all possibilities, right? There's actually a lot of possibilities in this space. So there's NGOs, there's advocacy groups that have a particular angle, right? You're gonna hear from some of those today that are thinking about specific issues. Then you have the academy and think tanks. You guys are in the academy now at Columbia where a lot of ideas are being tested, and some of the monitoring and evaluation that in the West might be done by local governments is gonna be done by the academy. Some of the, and I think of this as like idea generation. So these green dots are the idea generation in the space. And then woo, we have money. So this is where I think the money comes in. So the like turquoise dots are the people who are taking, the ideas are coming from the academy, the think tanks, the NGOs, there's lots of partnerships between this space and the money. And then all of the money, supposedly some of the money goes into local government and national government. Now how much, where, when, whether it should, those are a million questions that are gonna depend on the country context. So dots are, there's multi-institution, so that's the UN, the World Bank, and then there's bilateral institutions. There's a lot of these. There's a soup of these. There's JICA, the Japanese, there's CETA, there's NORAD. And I think, you know, I was talking to a friend about trying to get mini grids moving in East Africa, and NORAD finances all of this traditional utility infrastructure, but doesn't really get into the space of helping private sector mini grids. And so that space, even though they'll tell you over and over they're a small amount of money, they influence. And there's, again, a lot of opportunities, a lot of studies that get financed, a lot of individual projects. The EU has a, there's a pea soup of, or alphabet soup of bilaterals from the EU. And then finally you have foundations. And again, these come closer to, they found more often than not, the foundations are funding NGO and think tank money, think tank projects, but often they also have direct involvement with local governments and national governments. And I think I would say in my time in the space, it's moved closer and closer to direct financing with local governments. Okay, so that's the network. So now where have I been? I've sort of been all over the map on this. The last bubble where I am now are private consultants. So who makes the projects go? So then there's all these opportunities and you can work for ARUP, HRNA does some work, there's AECOM, there's WSP, and there are a lot of them and they often have an international practice. It's not gonna be as robust often as the other ones in the US, or it might be based in another country and you work directly on projects, you're doing RFP responses. And in this space, you're implementing, right? You're like making the idea that came up from the NGOs and the multilateral decided to finance it, you're making the project happen. So just a lot of different roles. And if you want, I've been trying to like assemble lists. So I can send that out later on like who are the players as you try to think about your career. So without further ado, my experience after I left the World Bank, I went and tried to be, you know, a private real estate developer because I believed in enabling markets. And it turns out that was just a lot of money. The financial crisis happened. I went back to get my PhD. And then I ended up back at the World Bank. It's like a career hazard for me. And I was working, I did my dissertation work in Tanzania and learned Swahili and really had an amazing chance to get to spend a lot of time in some of the big cities in Tanzania. And so I found myself working on the additional financing project for the BRT in Tanzania. And I bring this one up today because the goal was to like, the initial goal in 2008 of this project was to create a sustainable sense of what, like sustainable transport project, right? And it's funny because I noticed when I used to say sustainable when I was at the World Bank originally, sustainable meant fiscal sustainability. And most of the projects were not sustainable because they weren't fiscally sustainable. And now I was back and this idea that you all probably understand more of sustainability and green and that linkage started to come into my career. And it was kind of exciting because when I had first tried to start talking about like, what is green urbanism back in the day at the bank, that had no valence and now it does. But at the same time, the BRT project, huge cost overruns, on the most congested lanes. It took, how long did it take? Jonas, the guy who runs it, the project, who's been running it for now more than 20 years for the World Bank in Tanzania. I mean, we should call it the Jonas Bus Rapid Transit, because without that guy laying down and like making all this happen, negotiating forever. So we had to do an additional financing though, right? So you plan out the project, it's $100 million extra to like actually get the infrastructure moving. So that's kind of the context there. What ended up happening was they actually successfully did it. We got a BRT done in Dar es Salaam. It's pretty cool. There's still a lot of problems with it. I have a lot of misgivings. You know, we put the bus depot in the one area of the city that floods every single year. There's still a lot of like fatal infrastructure, bad decision making, but overall really cool that we got the first phase got done. The cool thing that then happened, there's a lot more funding that's gone into it. The African Development Bank decided to do a loan for the second line. And then the World Bank did it, which was unexpected. Originally said they wouldn't do it, and now they're doing the third and fourth line of the BRT. So the initial outcomes are like kind of cool. Supposedly it's 90 minutes in time savings round trip. Reality is with unclear impact on households. And there's been a lot of impact studies trying to understand, did this work, did it not work? And we don't know. So I bring this up because sometimes your goals, if you're at an international multilateral institution, it sounds really cool. It sounds like you're doing the right thing. Often you end up doing a road widening and you end up not exactly knowing if it worked the way you thought it was going to, because the incentives, the way the multilaterals are set up, you disperse and you move on. So, which is fun and exciting for a career, but kind of problematic when we're thinking about what is sustainability. I think in this case, I like it because the bank has stayed in it and decided to keep trying to make a full BRT work. The other thing that was kind of that you expect from a BRT, like the big sustainability gain is supposed to be big redevelopment and high density around the BRT. That hasn't happened at all. It's mostly slums around where the first line is. We'll see if it happens in other places. So kind of your urban planning impact, you know, you had an impact, but not exactly all of the big sustainability gains you expected to get. Okay, so am I going like way over time? Tell me when I go over time.
we have about like maybe 5 to 7 minutes?
5 minutes, perfect. Okay, so then the next project is with WRI. So WRI has, I worked at the Ross Center, which is their Sustainable Cities program. And they have offices in about seven countries. And so a lot of this world is about fundraising and trying to advocate for ideas. You can do some advocacy. We were definitely, there was a think tank. So we're doing a lot of hard research trying to advocate, but you can get more directly involved in putting new ideas out there in a way that I couldn't do at the World Bank. I was hemmed in from being able to put a really new idea on the table. And I was stuck kind of with the way I operated. WRI, I get to work directly with cities. At the World Bank, you always go through a ministry. It's kind of exciting. We put together something that I was pretty excited about. Three of my colleagues and I from the one, I ran the DC team, they ran the India and the Mexico team, and the three of us together put together these labs where we wanted to demonstrate that you could do small projects that changed green infrastructure investment in cities. So again, still I'm like further into the being able to try and make a sustainable infrastructure possible. We did a ton of research for 3 years. City Foundation was awesome and funded all this research. I'm not sure anybody's using it, but it was really cool. And we did manage to get from that first thing, we did manage to get the first bike share done in India through this project, through this funding. And now India's amazing because then, you know, we did it in one city and now it's in 60 cities or something, you know, the take up is fast. I mean, things come down fast, but they also go up fast. So pretty exciting. Anyway, so we pulled off this lab where we provided entrepreneurs in wastewater and energy really specific support and put them in front of a bunch of impact investors. And that we actually managed to get $26 million in seed funding from, I think it was about $200,000 in investment from the lab. So for us, this was pretty exciting. This is a multiple I hadn't seen, even when I'm talking about a $450 million loan with the World Bank. I was spending a lot more than that to get that done, right? And I knew it was going straight to local neighborhoods and it was targeted, it was place-based, it was in informal neighborhoods. So, and for my team, we brought in 5 new funders. So the reality of being in the nonprofit and think tank world is this matters. And we get this new narrative, right? And I can bring it to my colleagues at the World Bank. Okay, the last one I'm gonna try to do really fast here is what it's like to be working as a private consultant. So now I work with HRNA. I can never seem to get away from international work, even when I try to tell my kids that I'm gonna be around more. So this one, we put together this big strategy for the World Bank to do public real property asset management, right? So like you'd be surprised how few cities actually know all the buildings they own or who's in them or how they lease them. And so there's this big narrative in international development about this financing gap, like who's going to fill the infrastructure gap. We kind of made this theory and came up with a whole strategy of how the bank could support cities creating their own asset management strategies, right? Like how could they use their own money instead of constantly having to go to central government or to the World Bank? And this is a sad story because it was so cool what we did. And I'm like, I was so proud of myself. It felt like I had done my dissertation, but even more important, right? Because it was, the work was amazing case studies, super practical. It was super useful. And this is the problem with consulting. I hand it to my client at the World Bank. And if they do nothing with it, I can't do anything about it. I can tell you guys about it. So there's a trade-off here with when you're working in the private consulting is that you end up in a space where you have to do what your client tells you to do. Okay, so last slide. Do I have time for it? Last slide is kind of the big challenges and opportunities I see as someone that's kind of gone across that whole network is that implementing sustainable or inclusive city solutions really depends on where you sit in the network. the scale of it, the type of the project, who your counterpart is, and you as like students and future professionals can think about that. And think about where you want to be and be intentional about it. I'm not sure I was. I've kind of drifted with the winds. And if I could do it all over, I might be a little more intentional. The projects often take an extremely long time. No matter what anybody says, it's going to be a 3-year implementation of a BRT. That's baloney. Everybody at the table knows that's not real. So your outcomes are uncertain, right? Like you don't know that you're going to, because data sucks often. politics, this is a political game, right? Urban sustainability and infrastructure at the end of the day depends on the city manager, the mayor, and the national government. And those could change at any moment. So you have this trouble with, you're going to constantly be thinking about coordination, donor fatigue, keeping your donors excited, and then making sure there's some local ownership. So at the end of the day, though, my message is the opportunity to test incredible ideas and implement wild projects is enormous. So for me, I've gotten to do things that are so cool. I feel like I had no business as, you know, a girl from Cape Cod getting to do this stuff. So that's it. And I can't wait to hear what everyone else has to say. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Kate, for your presentation and sharing your chart and overview of working with international organizations, as well as the concrete examples you provided and as to where planners can end up working. We will circle back at the end with some questions and time for reflection, as well as some space to allow students to directly ask their questions. But for now, we will hear from Aline. And you are welcome to share your screen.
Okay, can you confirm Perfect. You can see my screen?
It's back to, and now it's in, yeah, perfect.
Great. Thank you, Maureen. It's difficult to follow what Kate was sharing because the scale that I'm going to talk about is much smaller. But that was very interesting to hear, and I'm looking forward to the discussion section of this call today. Thank you, Maureen, for inviting me. Pleasure to be here today, and it's really a pleasure because mostly when I was a student, this is what I enjoyed most, the sessions and the seminars where practitioners were invited to talk about the real world challenges and what could we do with our academic degree in actual practice. So in the next 10 minutes or so, I'm hoping to share with you a snapshot about my experience navigating the urban world through working in an international non-governmental organization that is focused on children well-being. And that was largely founded on the premise that poverty exists mostly in agricultural areas and on approaches that were intended to work with homogeneous communities that are stable, not moving around much, and change happens very slowly. So the journey to bring urban realities to the forefront of World Vision's agenda was really a long and a bumpy one. I'm gonna give you a snapshot about that today. But I'm excited about the success that is starting to show, and I'll share a bit of case studies to show that as well. But let me start with a disclaimer. I'm not an urban planner. I have half a degree in urbanism, and I will talk about that in a bit. My academic training, as Maureen shared, was in public health and focused on community development, and this community development bit was the strongest component that linked to my work in urban spaces, which started in Beirut in Lebanon. So when I finished my master's degree in public health, I joined World Vision as a program officer. I mostly did design, monitoring, and evaluation of projects in Beirut. One of those projects aimed at promoting peace building between youth from Christian and Muslim neighborhoods that were segregated along religious and political lines after the war ended in 1990. And this program was selected as one of the 6 pilots that World Vision started worldwide with an initiative that was meant to learn about how is urban vulnerability different and how how do our models help us either help us address this urban vulnerability and poverty, or are hindering us from doing any impact when addressing urban poverty and issues that children face in cities. So for 5 years, we learned from practice through action learning and research. In Surabaya, in Phnom Penh, in Siliguri and Kampur, in Beirut, in Johannesburg, and in La Paz. The cities that were part of this initiative were of different sizes, different challenges, different characteristics, but what they all had in common was the 3Ds that you see on the screen: density, diversity, and dynamics. For 5 years, we looked at how these 3Ds are influencing our work negatively or positively to establish, for example, a child-friendly city in Surabaya, or to mobilize informal settlement residents in Phnom Penh to advocate for their land rights, or in the case of Siliguri and Kanpur, to address the problem of child labor and child trafficking. In Beirut, to promote peace building among youth. In Soweto, in Johannesburg, to address youth unemployment issues. And La Paz, Bolivia, it was mostly focused on strengthening community-based disaster risk management and addressing urban violence. So we have learned from this research a lot of things. We've learned mostly what it takes to be effective in urban areas. And this is based on the approach that we were using, that was mostly a rural focused approach. So we learned that to be effective in cities, first we need to look at the city as a whole, not focus at on the neighborhood level where we are very comfortable doing our interventions and mobilization that we do well. We need to intervene at multiple levels. We need to have a focus on contextual issues. World Vision is a very large organization, and the focus is really child well-being, which is a very broad topic. And in cities, we need to focus on one thing, develop capability about it and do it well, and become a partner of choice for the government, for other organizations that are working, that will invest in this issue. We learned that partnering is not really optional. If we wanted to reach scale and sustainability, we need to work through partners and in collaboration with others. One of the things that Kate just mentioned about assets and the resources that exist at the city level, this is something that's very important to capitalize on. So as international NGO, we're usually comfortable with the funding sources that we have from private donations. And it really makes us blind to opportunities and resources that exist at the city level that can fund programs. And finally, the roles that we play and the skill set that is required from development or humanitarian practitioners in cities are really different from those required from those working in rural areas and more stable contexts. And we really need to be agile, shifting program focus whenever the context changes, and really diversify the skill set at the city level. So in those 5 years, in addition to what we were learning about the urban vulnerability and World Vision, I was also learning and growing on the personal level. I learned that I was quite quick in moving from my bachelor degree in health promotion to a degree in master's degree in public health. I learned that had I worked for a bit before going for the master's degree in public health, I would have changed my mind and pursued something different. So 4 years into this research, I went back to university and I started a master's degree in urbanism. But by the time I was halfway into the courses, I was promoted to a regional role for the Middle East and Eastern Europe regional office. And I was I had to develop an urban learning hub to share practice among the countries in this region. And that role meant that I have more travels and I have less time for my coursework. So I decided that I would finish the courses that I needed to take I would not do the thesis. And that was really one of the compromises I had to make because I thought it would be very helpful for me to understand the theories behind the urbanism and build on the practice that I've been getting from my work with World Vision. And I'm confident I got what I needed from this degree, although I haven't finished it. But I digressed here. So going back to World Vision, and the urban journey. 5 years into this action research and learning, topped by another couple of years of engaging with external organizations and partners that were leading on urban issues like UN Habitat and others, we launched the book Making Sense of the City, which is a compilation of learning from these pilots. And this book we launched during Habitat 3, which is the largest UN conference on managing urban areas and human settlements and cities, which happens once every 20 years. So that really puts World Vision on the map of international actors, really intentional about looking at cities from the lens of the child and youth well-being mostly, and looking at addressing urban poverty and violence in cities. In this book, it was the first time we launched the Cities for Children framework that you see here in the middle. And this is mostly the programmatic component of a citywide self-sustaining model that we developed. We added other components related to operational aspects. How do we organize ourselves as an organization in the city if we want to leverage on partnerships, depending on the size of the city? How do we resource our programs? Again, building on the idea of diversifying funding to build on resources that are actually within the city. And we really spent some time validating this model and implementing offices. And in 2020, we started rolling it out across all of World Vision's urban programs. And that's part of our scale-up plan moving forward to align all existing urban programs with this Cities for Children framework and the citywide self-sustaining model. The model has three components, as I shared earlier, but it's largely based on the premise that the city is a system. In World Vision, we were very comfortable working at this big orange circle here level, which was the neighborhood, based on the approaches that we had in the past. We realized that if we wanted to make sustainable impact in urban areas, we need to connect the interventions that we make at the neighborhood level with policy change at the city level. And that means we need to change the way we engage with different actors. And this is really an approach that we developed in consultation with urban planners in different offices that we work with. We came up with the citywide approach. I think it's influenced by planning principles to help us see what changes can be made and what type of interventions can we do at neighborhood, district, municipality, more regional and national levels, and what kind of role can World Vision play at each of those levels to influence policy change, for example, or to make sure that residents of an informal settlement have access to services that they are entitled for and their needs are being met. I'm going to give you three examples very quickly. They won't be examples that are similar to what Kate shared. I'm going to talk about the soft component that we do in the urban sphere and World Vision. So the first example is from our work in Lebanon. And I've started again in my career working with the Lebanon office on the peace building project. Since then until now, we've shifted and built this program based on learning. We still do a lot of work on social cohesion, especially between youth that are coming from different neighborhoods, from urban, low-income neighborhoods that host Lebanese and Syrian refugees, and also in Palestinian refugee camps. One of the examples I wanted to share from Lebanon is how we equipped a group of youth to do their own assessment of the built environment of the neighborhood where they are from and identify the issues that they wanted to address. And one of the issues was the lack of public space in a very contested and crowded neighborhood in Semilfil. one of the municipalities of the greater Beirut area. So they conducted their own assessment, they identified priorities, and they used that to lobby with the municipality to give them funding to revamp this space that you see here on the left, which was wasted land, into a sports facility for youth. So they did that, they got the money, they worked with, outsourced some of the work and made it happen. And then they got word in the neighborhood that some of the Syrian children are not allowed to go to this neighborhood. So they went back to the municipality and tried to lobby with the municipal board to make sure that this is an area that has access by everyone that lives in the neighborhood, regardless of their nationality or where they're coming from. So this is the kind of work that we're doing in this space. I'm gonna move to India in my next example. And this is an example of a program called Safer City Initiative in New Delhi. The issue that we're trying to address is safety of girls and women. And one of the interventions is actually providing self-defense training for girls. What started as a project with 56 girls within a few weeks reached 1,000 girls and young women. And this was done also in collaboration with one of the religious groups that had a vacant land again that they only use for special occasions and celebrations. And we agreed with them that we can use this space to do this training. And the training was actually done by the Delhi Municipality Police Department. So they brought in their staff to conduct this training. And once the municipality has seen how effective this training has been, they have asked them, the Department of Education in the municipality have asked World Vision to replicate this training across 485 schools across the city. So this is an example of how we started from a small initiative targeting 50 something urban residents, and we reached a bigger scale by influencing one of the municipal policies. The last example I'm going to give is from Honduras. And in Honduras, we're actually piloting a new approach for navigating urban fragility through an adaptive management based on scenario planning and continuous context monitoring that can influence the program focus. We work with marginalized groups in hard-to-reach neighborhoods that have no one working in them, no government presence, no other NGOs. The only actor that is present in those neighborhoods is the local church. And through our connection with this local church, we built credibility and trust for World Vision to be able to access these neighborhoods. We work on child protection from violence, especially with the issues of gang violence in these neighborhoods. We also work on building youth employability basically giving them skills to be productive. But it's not enough to make them ready for employment. What we actually do is we lobby with private sector to allow these youth to be employed in their companies, because those youth come from really marginalized and stigmatized neighborhoods. And how we influence private sector is by making municipality of San Pedro Sula decrease the taxes for companies that would employ youth from those neighborhoods. And really, this is another example of how we are linking with different actors and at different levels of the city. I didn't include anything in my presentation on challenges and opportunities. I'm hoping we can talk about that during the questions and answers. And this is all I wanted to share with you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Aline, for sharing your journey with World Vision International with us, as well as walking us through your personal journey of working on urban programming initiatives and developing action research and learning that is, you know, where you can see that it's directly impacting the people that are concerned. One of the main takeaways that I find compelling is this need to connect the change that you're doing on the neighborhood level with planning policies on the city level. But we will circle back with more questions from everyone and time for reflection. But for now, we will hear from Samer Saliba, who also has some slides to share with us and perhaps even a video. Take it away, Samer.
Thank you, Maureen, and thanks, Aline and Kate, for great presentations. Let me just bring this up. Assuming you guys can see this, thumbs up, great. Thank you again for inviting me. I'm very happy to be here. I am a son of Massachusetts of Lebanese immigrant parents, so I'm the sort of gateway between Kate and Aline in a way. I'm also started my career in city planning as a consultant, then moved to the International Rescue Committee, and I'm now at the Mayor's Migration Council, which is the closest I've come to working in a public administration, because we're an organization that's led by mayors for mayors. So I have a bit of experience in three different sectors, which has sort of shaped my thinking about international work in cities more broadly, and more specifically the role that I should, and more importantly, maybe should not be playing within it. So I'll touch on that a little bit. But as Maureen mentioned, what I want to talk about first and foremost is the Global Cities Fund for Inclusive Pandemic Response, which is the Mayor's Migration Council's response to the needs of migrants, refugees, and internally displaced within cities, specifically by supporting the city governments that have shown willingness and leadership in supporting them, but don't have the resources to do so. And Kate, I really liked your networked graphic, and I took a screenshot of it, I have to admit, because of all that little connections from this place to this place to this place to this place to this place, what we're really trying to do with the Global Cities Fund is demonstrate small model behavior of taking OSF's money and doing just one dotted line directly to the city governments. And all the other actors, if they want to engage, as they should engage, as Aline mentioned, that's their choice. But the projects that I'm about to present and the process that I'm about to present is really about city leadership in low to middle income countries, where cities who are hosting the most migrants and displaced are doing so with the fewest resources. So we're trying to address that, but I also encourage you all to think about why that is. Is it just because they're in low to middle income countries? Or are there greater forces at play within the international development field that's perpetuating that characteristic of how cities operate and the resources that they have to operate? So worth noting is that 90% of COVID cases are in urban areas. I think this number is up to actually 95%, perhaps not a surprise given the density of cities. And while all people within cities obviously are affected by COVID-19, we've seen even here in New York that the most marginalized within cities are adversely affected by COVID-19. That's the same for not only marginalized communities within New York, but also migrants and displaced around the world. For some reason, Venezuelan refugees in Colombian cities, for example, have higher COVID-19 case rates than the Colombian population. And that sort of speaks to how their vulnerabilities are compounded by ongoing crises. That said, they're the ones who are working in formal economies. They're the ones who have kept working on the front lines, have kept cities running. And so while they're the most impacted by it, they're also perhaps the most important to the response and recovery from COVID-19. I think national governments, because of their level of operation, have a hard time seeing this. But what we've seen is that mayors and city governments are really recognizing the value that migrants and refugees and internally displaced bring. And they're starting to, or they have stepped up in making sure that they're included in their COVID-19 responses. But as I mentioned, their resources far exceed, their needs far exceed their resources. So what we did was set up a rapid response fund of just $1 million that provided rapid support to city level projects, built the capacity of cities in low to middle income countries, And most importantly, perhaps created a proof of concept that you can and should directly fund city governments to do projects, and this is important, of their design. All of this, we received 30 applications or 26 applications to the Global Cities Fund. We had some criteria about what they needed to meet, but it was very light touch. And it was, what are your needs? Tell us what your needs are. And we'll go through a process to figure out how best to fund them. Ultimately, those 26 resulted in these five cities being awarded. Beirut, Lebanon, Barranquilla, Colombia, Mexico City, Mexico, Lima, Peru, and Freetown, Sierra Leone. I'll talk about the projects in a little bit. But I think more important than these five cities that put forward compelling proposals, that our selection committee moved forward, more important than us being able to grant these cities to enact these projects is the 21 other applications that we got that don't have funding. And that's really the thing that keeps me up at night personally, is why is that, right? There's clearly need. I think too often you see, I don't want to call out any names, but Bloomberg Philanthropies announcing, competitions for the most innovative projects and grants going to these city governments. Okay, great. But what about the shelter projects or the food distribution projects or the livelihood support projects that aren't groundbreaking, but have proven impacts on the cities that implement them, but they don't have the resources to do so? That's really where the need that we're trying to highlight with projects such as the Global Cities Fund. With that, I'll go through the projects really quickly. They're all on our website. But in Kia, we'll focus on providing livelihood support to enter the formal market to 100 refugees, migrants, and internally displaced, including internally displaced Colombians and Venezuelan refugees. This is fantastic because, as you may know, the Colombian government just announced a long-term protection status for Venezuelans who arrived in country before January 1st, 2021, so they can work formally and really contribute to their city's economy, their new city's economy, in the case of Venezuelan refugees, which is really exciting. Beirut will operate the city's first mobile health clinic, providing free and non-discriminatory COVID-19 testing to any individual. Basically, it'll go where it is needed most. And while we all know, especially Aline and I, and Maureen, about the challenges of working with Lebanese government, and those challenges are certainly real and should be acknowledged, working with city governments, sometimes you can sort of float beneath that layer. The politics, as Kate mentioned, will always be there. They will always be there. And one of the reasons why I wanted to move away from the humanitarian sector is to move away from this, what I sort of view as a false principle that humanitarians can remain apolitical. It's very different to do so in cities, especially when you work with city governments who are politically elected. But if you want to have meaningful impact, I think as Kate highlighted nicely, you need to engage in the politics in a safe, respectful, and diligent way, let me say. Lima is opening a comprehensive citizen service platform, specifically within one district of their city where they see a lot of migrants arriving, providing comprehensive services. We granted them $174,000. They're matching it with $800,000. So it just goes to show what a small amount of funding can actually unlock in terms of cities planning and what they're able to implement. Freetown, you'll hear from the mayor in a second, so I won't speak about their project too much. And then Mexico City will be doing direct cash transfers to 450 migrants, refugees, and internally displaced, which is really important given the sort of impact that COVID-19 prevention measures have had on Mexico City's informal economy, which constitutes 50% of their economy. And a lot of migrants and internal migrants work within, obviously, with it, along with everybody else within the informal economy of Mexico City. So what I sort of want to highlight from this whole project is that I moved from the IRC to the Mayor's Migration Council because I was advocating IRC country programs to work with city governments. Why was there in that middle step, really? And why was I there to begin with, bringing down, making connections to the grants, et cetera, et cetera? When these cities clearly have ideas of their own, but aren't being given the same resources as an IRC or as another international organization, I won't name names, as agreed with Aline prior to this call. you know, which they do have. And I think the case of Aline, you know, she really articulated why understanding context, why working in partnership is so important. But ultimately, I think if we're to address urban inequities, it starts with the ones that we are perpetuating as international actors. And specifically, some questions that I want to leave, especially those of you who are going into the international urban sphere, that you should be asking yourself before you take that first step. You hear so much about localization now. Even the term localization can be problematic. I was joking with a friend in Kampala City Government saying that we really need to localize localization. and he often says, how local is your local, right? Because there's so much talk about localization. What localization means in the humanitarian context is that they committed to having 25% of all international funding go directly to local partners. Not only is that goal not high enough, it hasn't been reached. And so it just goes to show, you know, who's asking about localization? Where is that localization coming from? If it's coming from the international sector, can it be considered localization? Who is in the driver's seat? You know, if you're saying, oh, we work with the city government, therefore it's local. Okay, but who's behind the wheel? You may be both in the car, but who's actually driving the car? And lastly, most importantly, are you adding or subtracting? And this is something that I struggle with quite a bit. You know, advising city governments from my apartment in New York, am I actually adding to their knowledge or am I subtracting? And sometimes what that requires is me shutting up and letting somebody like Mayor Eki Sawyer of Freetown speak to you herself about the projects that she's working with. And so with the last 2 minutes of my presentation, let me stop talking and let Mayor Eki Sawyer carry you through the rest of the way. Oh, wait.
COVID-19 is an urban challenge that has severely impacted migrants and displaced people living in cities, even though they have been essential to the response. Our job as mayors is to provide our residents with the tools needed for safe, healthy, and productive livelihoods. But cities' needs far exceed their available resources, and so we often fall short of the responsibility to protect our most vulnerable residents and miss out on the benefits of an inclusive recovery. Proven by our response to COVID-19, mayors are resourceful, resilient, and inclusive leaders in times of crisis. But cities around the world need more direct resources from international actors and national governments in order for us to fulfill our potential, scale effective solutions, and ensure all city residents benefit from our policies and actions. I'm a member of the leadership board of the Mayor's Migration Council. The MMC is a mayor-led resource to all cities that connects them to national, regional, and international dialogue while working with us to implement inclusive and sustainable migration and displacement policies and practices. As part of our work, the MMC has recently launched the Global Cities Fund to support city leaders delivering solutions to urgent needs of migrants and displaced people. With the support of the Global Cities Fund, Freetown will expand our waste management by helping 240 youth establish 40 sustainable waste management micro-enterprises, and that in turn provides waste collection services for households across low-income informal settlements. The project will provide jobs and long-term livelihoods for rural migrants, improve the city's public health and sanitation, and serve those who are most vulnerable. We hope cities are recognized as equal government partners. We're excited for international partners and national governments who work with us, not around us, and hopeful that our future collaboration will help cities emerge as dynamic centers of opportunity for all.
So thanks for listening. I think the last thing that I just want to repeat what Mayor Hakisoria said was we need to work with cities, not around cities. And that's really important if you're getting into the international urban development space. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Samer, for your for presenting your work at the Mayor's Migration Council and the, you know, showing us the valuable impact of the initiative and on five cities that that are very much struggling in silence, I would say, with the impact of COVID-19. I also want to thank you for giving us your critical and very honest view on how your role as a planner in humanitarian organizations versus other sectors like the public sector or the private sector can have very different impacts. And I feel like it's very important to be aware of that. So I would love to hear from our participants. You are welcome to turn on your cameras. You are, you know, just a quick reminder, if you'd like to ask questions directly to our panelists today, you may either raise your hand and I can call on you to, you know, speak directly, or you could type your question in the chat box. We do have a few questions in the chat box already, but we will start with, you know, a conversation to keep it animated. And then when people don't have any questions anymore, we'll go to addressing the questions in the chat. If no one has any questions yet to warm up, I'm wondering if the speakers have questions for each other.
I do. Kate, I have a question for you. I'm just curious about one of the things that we're working on at the Mayor's Migration Council is really not just funding cities directly, but influencing funding to cities directly and the financing mechanisms around that. And I'm curious, you talked a little bit about the bank's work in Dar as a BRT. And I'm curious, and I've seen it, and it's a beautiful project, so well done. But I'm curious if you have any thoughts about these types of projects, you know, sort of moving away from funding for infrastructure for growth as cities like Dar and Kampala and start to urbanize, but really focus more on infrastructure for distribution and focus more on social projects that maybe don't look as good or as shiny on a slide, but maybe more in line with some of the projects that Aline presented that World Vision is doing. And if there's a connection that could be made there.
Yeah, so it's a good question. So the big bank projects are infrastructure projects, right? And there's still, because of urban growth, there's an unmeetable amount of demand for the infrastructure projects, I would say. And governments like it, right? So because we're always talking about politics, they love a ribbon cutting. And every time I go to Dar, somebody's giving somebody a tour of DART. but the bank does have some model, like the CDD, the community development model that they have has worked pretty well. And I think, so my problem is I think you need a World Vision partner, and the World Bank doesn't know how to partner with World Vision well enough, right? Like, I would love to know, like, when I was at WRI, I thought we would be able to partner with the bank to do our work. Cause what I loved about that, the World Bank model, the WRI model was all of our staff were local. So we didn't have international staff in our local offices, which is very different than the World Bank. And it was kind of people that were advocating for green cities that were Mexican, that are Turkish, and that was important. And I thought, oh, wouldn't it be powerful if we could get World Bank funding to do our work? And it's nearly impossible to get the money out because it's going through central governments. Right. So the big IFIs and the big bilaterals, their finance ministers are conversing. So I have struggled to find, like, how can you underwrite it? How can you convince a mayor? You know, I think some of the work you were doing at IRC trying to show that, like, the refugees are in the humanitarian sector needs to think about cities. That's important. Like, I don't think that, you know, in my career, the work both of you have done at the beginning wasn't even on the table. Like, it was controversial to talk about mortgages for low-income people when I first got started in this space. And now the World Bank is, I mean, the project I thought about talking about, but it's not far enough along. The bank in Dar, the new project, they're gonna try to do some land reclamation to put a park in. That's never been done. That's never been done, right? Like, why? Public space, we're planners. Public space is like the most, one of the most important things to livelihood and happiness and every, like, to living in a city, you need public space, right? I'm at HRNA, we like deeply believe in this. And, you know, the international space, it's just coming up. You know, I know Bloomberg's problematic, but the work, the road safety stuff, talking about designing cities for pedestrians, which most poor people are pedestrians, like, that's radical. We weren't thinking about sidewalks. You know, I mean, why every World Bank project that puts a road in doesn't have a side, doesn't do complete streets? You know, why isn't there always a sidewalk and a bike path? I don't know. That's a simple way to get that change, and it doesn't happen. So I thought it was a really long-winded answer. I don't know if that causes any other questions out there in the world.
No, I think that's really helpful. And it is like, you know, there's at the New School, my director is Mike Cohen, who developed the bank's urban policy over the 80s and the 90s. And he has
amazing.
Yeah, great. And you know, he and I had a long conversation about this. And, you know, he said, you know, the bank has built all the easy roads in Kenya, which I think is fine.
That's the problem with the urban portfolio.
Yeah.
Because it's easier to expand a road. Then what does Dar need? Dar has 10% of the city has any type of improved sanitation. Number one issue, let's fix the sanitation problem. Do you know how hard that is? That's a 20-year investment, trying to get into everybody's little neighborhood and get everybody. I mean, Kampala's done some amazing work on this. Like, Kampala's way ahead of everybody else, but getting the bank to finance that, that's hard, you know, and getting the local government willing to say, yeah, like the national government and the local government being like, yeah, I want to go into the informal settlements and fix the sanitation problem. It's not glamorous, you know?
Well, if they're not interested in, I wrote this down, the public real property asset management strategy, I'm certainly interested in it. And I know that the cities that we work with would certainly be interested in it. To sort of like wean
them. I'll send it to you.
Yeah, no, please. But to sort of wean themselves off of somewhat problematic financing mechanisms to actually do the work that they want to do with their own.
Yeah. And it's a spectrum, right? Like, we should be thinking of it as spectrum, and often municipal finance is stepwise, right? And everybody's trying to, like, sorry to cut everybody off, trying to work towards bonds, and bond financing isn't a reality for 99.999% of cities, but there's a lot of other local resources that you could think about. So, Aline, I don't know if you want to say anything.
I have a question that is in the chat that pertains to all three of you, and it tackles all of your journeys coming from very different places and working in different places. So for someone who's interested in pursuing NGO or multilateral institutional work such as, you know, working for the UN or World Bank, but are coming from a private planning / consultant background, how do you make the move? How do you make the shift? And I know, Samer, you used to work at WSB and then you shifted to IRC, and I was like, show me the ropes. How does this work? So I'm sure a lot of, it's a little bit opaque as to how you can enter this world. Many of these places are large institutions that are tough to get a foot through, and many positions require prior experience in the public sector. So, Kritika's question is, how do you break the barrier?
With dumb luck. I think it's funny. I tell this story a lot, but I think it's important, especially with what Kate just said. When I found out, I didn't know that the IRC existed, but I was in my Wagner master's program with somebody who's the head of Sean Penn's core response and doing fantastic work now, Anne Lee. she was in the humanitarian sector and getting her degree in planning because the humanitarian world was becoming more urban. And so we're sort of crossing paths, and she said, you know, there's this job at the IRC, you might be interested in it. I said, what's the IRC? And the IRC had just put out a policy statement saying that the international humanitarian community needs to work with city planners. They also put out a job description saying, we're hiring for an urban response learning manager, must have 5 years experience in the humanitarian sector. And so I applied and I put both documents in front of them. And I said, well, I don't have this, but I have this. And are you about what you're saying the humanitarian community should do? Or are you saying that I should have 5 years of experience? And I think that sort of triggered something in their mind, which is sort of like, why was that in our job description to begin with? What kind of experience actually is valuable if you're entering in that space? And I think if you're moving from the consulting world into the NGO world, which is exactly what I did, I think you have to make the case yourself and look for opportunities. You know, if the opportunity isn't there, it may be that you need to create it. And it takes a lot of time to understand how these organizations are working, where they're working, what quote unquote urban projects they have going on. But I think, again, as to what Kate mentioned, like the space is opening up and there are more opportunities, but you have to make the case for yourself as urbanists entering into humanitarian spaces. About why that experience is valuable. And I think more and more that case is becoming easier to make.
Yeah, I would add to that overview by Sam, building on your point that the opportunity is there. So really right now, it's one of the great moments to enter this sphere, because there are, on the one hand, we are increasingly seeing humanitarian needs in urban areas. So there's an increase in urban warfare, there's an increase in urban violence and conflicts. And more we're seeing that poverty is increasing in urban areas. And the urban poverty for a child, for example, who is growing in a poor urban neighborhood, they are doing much worse than their peers in rural contexts and in better off communities and urban areas. So if we look at this whole urban world, not only from the planning perspective, but as a context, the need is increasing, but also the opportunities are increasing, because in 2015-16, there were two key moments. The first one was the creation of the new urban agenda during Habitat 3 conference, which sets the agenda for the next 20 years for organizations that are working in the urban sphere. It tells donors where to put this money. And for the first time, sorry, that was in 2016. In 2015, for the first time, a global goal on urban was created in the Sustainable Development Goals, and that was the goal 11. And there's really more intentional focus by governments and member states and the UN about looking at cities and the issues in cities. And for the first time ever, we're seeing, for example, UNICEF has urban strategy in their focus on children. So there are really opportunities. Haiti earthquake 10 years, more than 10 years ago, put the urban focus as a priority, because humanitarians didn't have that planning thinking when doing their humanitarian work. It was mostly the soft and the direct development and direct aid that we used to give. On finding the spot for entry or an entry point, I haven't done a shift from another sector. So I've always worked in the humanitarian and development sector. But what I know is that we are increasingly in demand for planners to help us understand in our urban strategies in countries where we operate, for example, to help us understand the landscape that would help us build city strategies and who to connect with and what actual interventions do we want to plan. Also at the global level, there are so many opportunities for short consultancies that urban planners can do for NGOs and UN agencies. So that would be a good entry point to accumulate some experience from these short consultancies at city level or globally that could allow an understanding of this a sector and the actors that are in it and could be an entry point for this field.
Thank you so much, both Samer and Aline. I just wanted to, Kate, sorry, I just want to say that we're out of time. However, we could stop the recording, and if some students have a little bit more time to hang around with us, you can ask your questions directly to the speakers. So let me conclude, and we will end, and then we can stay on informally, which is how we used to do it in the real world, but unfortunately, Zoom world is slightly different. So I want to thank all of you on behalf of GSAPP and the Urban Planning Program in particular for presenting today. We really appreciate you taking the time, and I think the audience will agree that this was an illuminating discussion, though there's still so much to be said. We will be on spring break next week, so please make sure to join us 2 weeks from now on Tuesday, March 9 at the same time for our next LIPS, which will be with Nisha Botchway. Thank you again all for coming, and I hope everyone has a great day.